risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
God has raised Jesus from the dead. Give us new life and new hope.
God has claimed us as God's own. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
A reading from the first letter of John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. When it was evening on the day of the resurrection, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the people, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. Please be seated. As one quick wit put it, what does one do for an encore 1 week after the resurrection? A week ago, Easter Day at this service, the cathedral was packed with about 3,000 worshipers, trumpets, timpani, streamers, glorious music, flowers, worship, Eucharist, every manifestation that we could imagine and planned that would be appropriate to sharing the good news of the resurrected Christ. Here we are, 1 week later. There are a few empty seats in the house. No trumpets, no timpani, no streamers. So we and the disciples gather together to learn how to live into the joy, the promise, the purpose that we proclaimed last week. And I think there are many lessons that we can take from the gospel account of the disciples and where we find them in Scripture this day and where we may find ourselves. In the gospel lesson you just heard, the disciples had actually received the report from the women that the tomb was empty, that they had seen the risen Lord. Yet we find them locked tight behind closed doors, all closed up in a room together, and as the gospel lesson tells us, out of fear of the authorities and the possibility of retaliation. That what might happen to them was precisely what happened to their beloved friend and rabbi and teacher, Jesus. And what does Jesus do, seeing all of his disciples behind locked doors? Jesus appears, despite the locks, and offers words of peace, the first words out of the resurrected Christ's mouth are words of peace. Peace be with you. Essentially, a forgiveness to the very disciples who had deserted him and denied him. Jesus goes on to give them what they need to really grab hold of the reality of the joy and the purpose that awaited them. He shows his wounds. He gives them a commission. Just as the Father has sent me, so I send you. And then he breathes the life-giving, life-empowering Holy Spirit upon them and teaches them a very important lesson about forgiveness. Essentially, with the words of peace, making the point that you are to forgive as you have been forgiven. I think forgiveness is part of the key in not only the lesson you heard this morning, but a life lesson. As a priest, over the years, as I have heard people offer confession, there are a variety of things that are going on. But at the core, there's almost always a thread of a need for being forgiving someone else, but usually it's struggling with being able to forgive ourselves for something we have done. And look at the disciples. They have ostensibly locked the doors to keep what's outside that they consider threatening away from them. But what about the other side of that door? What have they locked in? Their fear, their shame, their remorse, their unworthiness, their sense of unforgiveness. Jesus comes to them and unlocks that door to liberate them, to live fully as resurrected people, to go from being disciples, followers, to apostles who proclaim the great good news and joy that they have received. But I think it's a struggle for all of us. We all have things that we lock up inside that need to be unlocked to liberate us, to experience that same Easter joy and purpose. In her book, Traveling Mercies, Anne Lamott writes about an experience of forgiveness in her own life. She says that as a Christian, she'd never really obsessed much about forgiveness. She actually liked to hang on to unforgiveness with people that had hurt her, and had worked on that really pretty faithfully for several decades. She came to a point in her life, though, that she knew that she needed to let go of that. So she made the decision that she was going to start on that path of forgiving people. And she decided to take a page out of C.S. Lewis's book, who said, if we really want to learn how to forgive, it's perhaps best to start with something easier than the Gestapo. And so Anne Lamott put aside all the people that were her arch enemies and decided instead to focus on someone who she'd only recently begun to hate. hadn't known her quite as long, and she dubbed her enemy Light, L-I-T-E. Well, this woman was the mother of one of her son's best friends in school. Her son Sam was in the first grade with this boy, and enemy Light was one of those people, you know, who always has it all together, and Anne Lamott, maybe not so much. And it started innocently enough. Anne Lamott was a little bit confused about school schedules and such. She hadn't bothered to read the papers that the school had sent to her in advance of the start of school, and it was October before she figured out that on Wednesdays, school ended 45 minutes earlier. Well, enemy Light, wanting to be helpful, said, you know, Anne, if you need any assistance with knowing how the classroom runs and schedules, I'd be very happy to help you. Strike one. Then it got more serious. Enemy Light showed up at the door to pick up Sam for the field trip because, of course, she was one of those moms who drove all the kids on field trips. That was not the issue. She showed up wearing a jacket and latex biking shorts. Why? Because she worked out all the time and she could wear latex biking shorts. Anne Lamott noted that she had on her really fat pants, and it was a serious strike too. All the women in this congregation know what I'm talking about. At that point in time, she decided she really needed help. This was not going well. And so she got a box that she called God's Inbox, got a piece of paper, wrote the woman's name on it, folded it up, put it in the box, and prayed, help. Well, it was kind of going okay, and then it really went over the top, because you see, her son Sam was having troubles learning how to read. He was what was called a late reader. Enemy Light's son, guess what, was an early reader. And so Enemy Light, again trying to be helpful, offered to Anne the books that her son had already whipped through, wanting to give him early reading books so that he might be able to progress. And let's just say that was a really significant strike. Tough to live with. She got the name back out of the inbox, put exclamation points after it, put it back in the box, and seriously prayed for help. But then one day, something happened. She went over to Enemy Light's house to pick up her son. And Enemy Light was, you know, being warm and friendly and gracious, invited her to sit down and have a cup of tea, and Anne really had no interest in that. But her son Sam had misplaced his knapsack, so they were going to be there a little while he looked for that. And she sat down, she had the cup of tea, and as she was preparing to leave, something changed. She describes it as the veil being dropped, and that she realized for the first time that those were her issues, not enemy Light. That she was the one concerned that her son was not learning enough in school, that she was the one concerned that she was out of shape. That she realized that she had put all these things on enemy Light to carry for because it was too painful for her to carry them herself. She unlocked the key to forgiveness. What might any one of us still have locked up that we need to let go? To hear the words of peace from the resurrected Christ, to be forgiven, to be commissioned, to receive deeply and fully the life-giving, life-empowering breath of the Holy Spirit. My prayer this day is that each one of us will attend to those things which we need to let go, to unlock our hearts, our spirits, to go forth from this place, proclaiming with joy and purpose and transformative love that He is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Life-giving God, you strengthen the faith of the believing and quicken the hope of the doubting through the resurrection of Jesus, your Son. He comes giving peace and breathing spirit, calling forth Easter joy. Alive in Christ and filled with the Spirit, we pray for the church, for the world, and for all you have made. Jesus, light of the world, bring the light and peace of your gospel to the nations. Jesus, Lord of life, Jesus, bread of life, give food to the hungry and nourish us all with your word. Jesus, Lord of life,
in your
mercy, hear us and accept our prayers. Jesus, our way, our truth, our life, be with us and all who follow you in the way. Deepen our appreciation of your truth and fill us with your life. Jesus, Lord of life, Jesus, good shepherd, who gave your life for the sheep, recover the straggler, bind up the injured, strengthen the sick, and lead the healthy and strong to new pastures. Jesus, Lord of life, Jesus, the resurrection and the life, we give you thanks for all who have lived and believed in you. raise us with them to eternal life. Jesus, Lord of life.
You come, O Christ, to Easter us, to overcome every barrier we create in your resurrected presence. Make us witnesses to your continual life among us, kindred living together in unity and peace. By your great grace, resurrect in us a will for the common good, sharing what we have, selling what we own, until there is no needy person among us. Enter this room today, O Christ, and Easter us. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. The peace of Christ be always with you. Good morning, and I want to add my own word of welcome to Washington National Cathedral. I'm Gary Hall, the Dean, and on behalf of Bishop Mary Ann Buddy and all of my colleagues who work, worship, volunteer, and serve here regularly, it is my pleasure also to add a word of welcome to that extended by Canon Cope at the beginning. This place is the nation's church, and it is a house of prayer for all people, and the table behind me is God's table. So whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith, you are invited to that table. You are welcome to receive the bread and wine of communion. Our ushers will direct you to the communion stations, which are around the nave. If you'd rather receive a blessing than take communion, please let us know that by folding your arms across your chest, and we'll know that's your preference. After you've come forward to communion, you're invited to go to War Memorial Chapel on the south side of the building. And there our healing ministers are stationed, and they will be there to pray with you, for those who are on your hearts, and to give you the laying on of hands for healing. Then afterward, we do have coffee in the West End, and as Jan said earlier, our congregation potluck for April is upstairs in Perry Auditorium, and all are invited to that. We have three groups visiting us this morning. One is St. Mark's from Ohio. Where are you all? Oh, there you are. Great. And then Grace Lutheran School from Florida. All right. And then St. Michael's School from Arizona. All right. Welcome to all. We're really glad that you're with us this morning. Okay, Canon Cope, come forward. You may have seen either in our press release or in our email blast this week that Bishop Buddy and I have appointed Jan Cope, our vicar, to be the provost of the cathedral. And her duties, so her job is changing and getting a little more intense in some ways. And her job is changing, and she is now working with me on the strategic and missional aspects of the cathedral's life, but also she is going to be overseeing our development and fundraising efforts and is going to be going with me to various parts of the country to invite people into supporting the cathedral's ministry. So this is a great day in the life of the cathedral and a great recognition of Jan's great abilities. There's good news here and there's bad news. The bad news is that she will no longer be the vicar. The good news is that she will still be here every Sunday. So congratulations to Jan, and everyone wishes you well and is so excited about this appointment. The bishop and I are now searching for a person to fill Jan's current role on an interim basis, and then we will go through a process of choosing a successor for that role, but Jan will be very much in our life for the months and years to come. So that's great news for everybody. God has been generous to us in so many ways, and we respond to God's generosity now by giving to support the mission and the ministry that God does through the church and through this cathedral church. So let us with gladness present the offerings and the oblations of our life and our labor to God.
Thank you.
with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. For the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation. In the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, but above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O God, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with Mary, the mother of Jesus, Peter and Paul, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Rejoicing in God's new creation, let us pray with confidence, each in our own language, the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. people of God. Thank you. Let us pray. Almighty God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, you have assured your children of eternal life, and in baptism have made us one with him. Deliver us from the death of sin, and raise us to new life in your love, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. God the Father, by whose love Christ was raised from the dead, open to you who believe the gates of everlasting life. God the Son, who in bursting from the grave has won a glorious victory, give you joy as you share the Easter faith. God the Holy Spirit, who filled the disciples with the life of the risen Lord, empower you and fill you with Christ's peace. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.